And the change that comes in there may invalidate the design that I do today. That is the fear. Of course, the fallacy here is that design is this thing that is cast in stone, and now that it is written down according to law, it cannot be changed except by an act of parliament. That is not true, but that's the way we tend to fear design changes. Now if you take it and say that, okay, let's be a little more challenging and say, what about architecture changes? Can we do them? The question is much more frightening. So that's the story I'm going to tell this afternoon. So, and along the way, I will also make one or two disparaging comments about people who go for sprint zero. Okay? So if I insult some of you, I'm sorry. But the whole idea is that let's try to learn from it. Okay? So architectural hiccups. So this is a story where I went to a company and I was doing some little bit of consulting for them, and this company was basically building a what is called an MMOG. MMOG stands for massively multiplayer online gaming. So this was the product. Okay. So I'll give you a little bit of background and then we'll go through the story. Alright? Now, one of the reasons why I picked up this case was a lot of things were in place. So it wasn't a total mess, it wasn't a disaster. So this is not a failure story. Neither is it a complete huge success story. It's just a real story where some things went well, some things went badly, and not all the wisdom that was available, let's say in Scrum, was applied. And maybe that was a mistake. So let's see. So this was a Dutch company, very well funded, they had a lot of money, and they were, there was a time, I don't know if it's true even now, but US laws, or you know, even in India, there are some laws that prohibit some sort of gambling and online betting and things like this. I'm really not an expert in this, but Netherlands at one point was pretty much a leader in this kind of software, which allowed a lot of people to play poker online or do betting online or things like this. So this company was basically wanting to build an online poker market. They were already an online lottery giant. And interestingly, you know where they place the servers? They place them in Gibraltar. Do you know where Gibraltar is? It's in the south of Spain, you know, just across Africa. So that's where they placed it on. So, and the whole idea was to build a complete offering of online betting, especially for poker and a bunch of other games, card games, and open the environment to various professional players who make a living out of playing online. And the idea was first version in 12 months, all right? And they did consider a bunch of different technologies here, strangely. The client was bespoke C++ application. They had the server in Java, which is not a very common combination. And they had their own protocol to communicate between the server and the client. So client is where the poker player would log in and start playing. And they use some their own testing scripts. We'll talk about testing a little later again. The server was basically on the Linux platform with a MySQL database. Database was actually not a very important part of the application per se. It was just for recording all the moves that were played. And then there was a RabbitMQ messaging. Red Dwarf was actually a particular Java-based server framework. So this is not J2EE. It has nothing to do with any of the J2EE stuff. So server-based framework which is able to handle certain kinds of asynchronous transactions. So that was, I think the name has even changed. Red Dwarf is no longer there. I think it's called Dark Star later or something else. Okay. So some of these, couple of these technologies are not even available now. They've been evolved into better technologies. Okay. Okay, how about the project background? A few things here. Though this is an agile conference, etc., etc., was the project scrummy? No, it wasn't very scrummy. They had no scrum master, they had no product owner, they had, they had stand-ups, that was okay, but not really anything that you would recognize normally as a good scrum team, nothing of that sort. Did they have the right people? And this is one reason why this is a good case study, because they did have the right people. So one of the lead architects in this, he's a friend of mine, and he worked along with me when we worked in Iona Technologies. Okay. So how many people have heard of Korba? Just show of hands. Okay, bunch of people have heard of Korba. Okay. So Iona Technologies was a leading vendor of Korba. The reason I mentioned this is because Korba is this middleware that helps distributed applications talk to each other, even if they are in different platforms, right? So we were the team that was the engineering team that built Korba services and maintained the Korba product. So we understood distributed applications very well. So he was the lead architect here. He had also earlier worked in another online gaming company. So that was great background. We had other people who also knew something about extreme programming. So we had a very good team. It was a good, strong team. One of the lessons I would like to mention is you can have a good, strong team, but you can still make plenty of mistakes. Yeah, you can still make plenty of mistakes. And so the people were not bad. Even looking back, even in hindsight, a bunch of people were good. Prioritization, what's that? So the thinking at that point, because so remember, we came from an XP background. Many of us came from an extreme programming background. Extreme programming does talk about prioritization, but it is not as clear and as insistent on prioritization as Scrum is. So somehow prioritization was not something that we really paid a lot of attention to. Because in extreme programming, you do pay attention to it, with, especially if your system is on production. But we had 12 months to go, there was nothing on production, so we didn't pay attention to prioritization. Did we know exactly what to build? Yes, we thought we knew exactly what to build. Who is we? Not me, the people in the team as well as the business. Because they have been in this online betting and various applications, so they knew exactly, oh yeah, we know what to build. So interestingly, the team also consisted of a couple of professional poker players. So it's not just developers and testers, but you had a couple of poker players who were hired to play, all right? So that is good. So why is it relevant to a conference like this? Because one good thing was, because of the background of the people, we did everything in an iterative and incremental value. If you learn nothing about XP and Scrum, it is okay as long as you realize that all software development is essentially iterative and incremental. Your understanding of what you're going to do, your understanding of how you're going to do, all this improves in cycles. It doesn't come one fine day and then everything is just a, it's not that after that you switch off your brain and just do it. So it was all incremental and iterative. So that was the background, alright? So let me just take you quickly through how the application looks like, alright? These funny faces you see here on the left, they're meant to represent poker players, and they're with cards, and they are accessing this server over the internet. Yeah, they've got to download the client first. This is the backend infrastructure of that application, and you basically have a database which is just there to store data. It is not really to provide any transaction support. Everything happens in memory. So you've got a tournament server and a game server. You've got a player portal and a lobby server. Okay. And these are connected through, you know, a messaging service. Just to spend a couple of minutes on this, the game is played on tables. And you can have, so that would be one round of game. So that is provided by the game server. You can have a bunch of games played across different times to make a tournament. And you needed some server to take care of a tournament. In this server, you could play multiple tournaments at the same time. Okay. So the tournament server would use the game server to provide a tournament interface to anyone who is joining the game. And to join the game, they come to these people, they come to the lobby server. Okay. So I'll just this is what? This is all PowerPoint. It's death by PowerPoint. So let me just try to show you some real screenshots. Can you see that? I mean, you can see that, but can you see what's written? Probably not. Anyway, so on the left side, the person will come in, and this is the lobby, and there's a list of tables, and they can choose games or tournaments from the left hand side, and a bunch of game tables that they can choose. And once you choose, you can also get to get the details of the seats available, bunch of things. And many of the professional poker players, they also know who the other good players are and whom to play against. And there's a huge community there out there, and they tend to make the choices according to who else is there on this. So that's the lobby. Okay. So these are screenshots from. It is gambling, yes, it is gambling. And the reason the servers are in Gibraltar is because of the laws there, which mean that you can place your servers there. In many countries, they don't allow it. So anyway, I think that's a separate conversation we can have if you're interested in gambling. So that's the lobby list. This is how a game table looks like. So they've got names and maybe some numbers which represent the amount of chips they have or the money they have, and that's the table and so on. And what you see on the right is a chat window. So there are also chat windows. It's all simultaneous. It's a part of the client. Okay. So this is how it looks like, and this is at where you can see information about tournaments and so on. And this, it's a bit Las Vegas style maybe, I don't know. But this is where players can make that selection on which game to play. All right? Just a few screenshots. So let's look at what was known to this team when they started. So when they started on this project, by the way, they didn't have very strong project management process or anything like that. So when they start on the project, the lead developers and the architects, etc., they knew most of this. These players who are playing, they are serious, and there's a lot of money that is being bet on them. It is easily in the orders of many millions every day. And if you are bringing a new product into the market like this, the reputation is very important, because quickly players find out that it is not good, it's not reliable, they will just desert it, and they're going to talk to each other. So it is very critical that if this is made on, is open online, that it is really stable and robust. So the server needs to be robust, it's network ready, it should be able to recover from network errors. It has to support for statefulness. Because every player in the whole game is a series of states, and even if someone is disconnected, they need to be able to go back, within the rules of the game, and you need to record those states, so it has to support that as well. Okay. It should be easy to interface with external systems. I think this is a bit of a wish list, because as far as I knew, this is an interesting point, because the external systems they planned to interface with, did not come up, and the external system they never thought they would have to interface with did come up. So I'll give you an example of it a little later, and that shook their planning basically. It has got to be highly threaded. You have a minimum supportable concurrent player base of at least 20,000 people simultaneously. Remember, it's also graphic. So all these messages have a lot of content in that as well. And logged in players don't always play, but ad load. It's a bit like Amazon. If you visit an Amazon site, even if you don't buy anything, you don't add anything to the shopping cart, you're already in a transaction. Because if you click on one thing, it tells you, okay, people who have shown interest in this have bought other items like this. So even if you don't do anything on Amazon, you're already initiating some kind of transaction. So like that, people who are not even playing, they're just watching, they're logged in and watching, they're putting load on this system. Because the system has to keep sending them messages. Logged in players don't always play but add loads. Speed and order of messages exchange between client and server is important because that's how the game follows. Okay. Are you with me or have I completely lost you? Oh, you're still there. Okay. So this is what was known at pretty much the starting of the project. The next slide is more requirements, more things that the server must do. But most of these were not known, or at least people didn't think of them when they started. So these were discovered by and by. And these are, some of them are design aspects, some of them were architecture aspects. But basically what happened was we needed randomness. And it has to be proven to be random because the system is going to deal the cards for a game. And it must be random and it must be proven to be random. Okay. Now, when this system was built, the first about 3-4 sprints, they had a simple game to be played. They just used the Java library to generate random numbers. And that seemed fine enough. But later the business said, we're not too sure about whether this is okay. It's probably not good enough, but we have to show that it is random. And probably we can't use this. So I'll tell you the story in a second, but that created quite a bit of issue. Then the other interesting thing is arbitrarily fired timers affect software behavior. I don't know if it is uniformly true, but you know there are timers in Java. You can set a timer and then you can kick off an event. The timer guarantees that the event will start, suppose you set a timer for 2 minutes. What the timer guarantees is that it will not fire before 2 minutes. It doesn't guarantee it will fire at 2 minutes. It could be 2 minutes or it could be 2 minutes, 1 second or 2 seconds or something. So what the problem that this generated is that when players are playing, you cannot wait forever for someone, because it's an online game, you can't wait forever because one person can bring the game to a halt or a tournament to a halt. So you maintain certain time limits and you try to you try to use timers to enforce these time limits, but then they also create problems because they don't quite fire in that time. So that's another issue that came up. Player may log in just to watch others, and network connection can drop at any time. Well, this is something that should have been anticipated, but even though it was there as requirement earlier, I remember this first, the network connection being dropped because this was a big bug that killed one whole sprint. So if you look at the previous slide, we said network ready, right? And here's the thing, we all said network ready and everyone nodded their heads as if they understood what it is. But when it actually happened, then people, it's that. So it's very strange. It's all, it's about communication sometimes, I feel, We hear things, but we don't hear them. So anyway, players may decide to sit out and rejoin at any time. So you also have to provide facilities where people can rejoin, which basically means that you need to keep track of their moves and their money as well. And multiple simultaneous tables, multiple simultaneous tournaments, all these you are supposed to support using the server. And the last but not the least, the game history must be retained. It's a legal requirement because you are distributing money, you are collecting and then redistributing money, and if someone has a question, it should be auditable. Okay. So these are some of the things that came into the requirements. Things like game history must be retained. things like arbitrarily fired timers and randomness, these did create problems for the architecture as well. One more thing that is not there on the slides is the whole idea of timeout, and that was not a part of original design, and it cuts across all screens. If you are there on the screen and not doing anything for a long time, you are supposed to be logged out. And remember, this is a custom made client, so this was not designed earlier. So that was another problem. Issues with guaranteeing that we have delivered these requirements, basically to prove that would require one to show test results, and it's tricky to test software which is asynchronous. We have to show that many users are playing this game according to the rules of the game. Functionality also has to be maintained. He's asking testers, and then it's also asking testers to be good and bad poker players. The problem with testing poker is people also very often have to play simultaneously. Okay, can we do that easily manually? No. Can we do that easily automatically? There's no easy way. There's absolutely no easy way. So this is something that the architects had to take care of upfront. I think we've discussed some of these things. So let me go to the next slide and run you through an example of asynchronous behavior and try to tell you the kind of issue that had to be solved. And this was not anticipated. This is not what was anticipated when the project started, that asynchronous behavior has to be handled. Okay, so let us say there are four players. You got player one played the step one is okay. So player one started. Step one is player two, P2 plays, and then step two, the P3 is either disconnected or just sits out of the game. Okay. Then step three, in player four is able to close the game. Now there's a new hand that is dealt, that is a new round, a new hand is dealt. Now at this stage, P3 is now either rejoining the game or is reconnected. P3 does not need to know what has happened, all the things that have happened in between, because those messages, if they are just simply queued, then they will just irritate the person. So you don't want them to be queued, you want the latest message to be sent. So that is what the server has to do, and this is an example of the synchronous behavior. So basically there is a mechanism by which the server is sending messages, the server is handing control to the client, and then if the client does not receive any more messages, the server is only has to send the latest state to the clients. Okay, so this, how did they handle this? Well, fortunately what they did is they managed to fit this in, because it's a custom built protocol. They were lucky in this. They actually managed to build it into their communication protocol as an application construct. It's their own protocol. So they basically said that we'll have a code by which we'll understand what is the last move that you received, or the last move you did, and the latest we have, and if there is no correspondence, then we just send the latest. Otherwise, we will replay some of the older ones. So these are some of the things they did to make this happen. Some of the problems detected along the way: disconnected player was not able to re-login at all. There were negative balances for players. If a player's connection to the game server was lost, his balance of money was not returned, and this is not fair. So the business did tell that you are supposed to return his or her money because they have not been able to play the entire round. The poker rules to raise the stakes, they were not applied correctly. So a bunch of things that were not being handled properly. So tournament ended abruptly and the winners were declared even though the tournament was actually cut off in between. So bunch of things that the team discovered along the way. Most of the solutions of this was provided by the teams themselves, but the critical thing here was the communication between the teams and the business owners was good. So that is what Scrum says in terms of a product owner. There was no product owner here. So what happened was the business did manage to tell the developers which kind of mistakes are okay and which kind of mistakes are not okay. I think at this was somewhere in midpoint of the project. I think at this point the business was understanding that not everything is always possible. When I go to projects and look at companies, sometimes I feel business or on the stakeholder side, they feel that everything should be possible cheaply or any business requirement can just be taken care of. It is not always true. And unless you have this collaboration between both sides, I think there is more conflict than resolution of this conflict. So here what I'm saying is if the tournament ends abruptly, or especially if a game ends abruptly, so the developers explain, we cannot guarantee 100% of the time that the server will never come down or some part will go off the rails. We cannot guarantee this. Mostly it will work. But what we can guarantee is we can always keep a guarantee of that we would record a log of what has happened. So that we can guarantee, but we can't guarantee that every game will end successfully. So then the business said, that is fine. Then what we can do is if the game does not finish it, but it, something abrupt happens in between, as long as we can simply return all the money that people have put in, the same money back, it's okay. People don't like it, but at least it's acceptable. They don't end up with negative balances, or, you know, some wrong winner being declared. As long as that doesn't happen, it's okay. So this is actually not very consciously, but it's actually a prioritization exercise that did happen. Going ahead, about testability, a few of the steps that were taken to increase testability. One of the main things is actually use the second point, impregnate code base with event watchers. So you actually have the code base, they used some pieces of code that you could inject while you're doing testing to look for certain events that were fired. This basically based on the game, and this would help us run multiple tournaments and see the list of set of steps. It would help a lot in testing. Remember, in testing you have to prove that what you are dealing of hands is random. If it is random, when you run it again, obviously you will get different numbers. Then how can you prove that the first time it was random? So this is a place when they got into this whole discussion, then there was this external stakeholder who talked to some auditors, regulators of online betting, and they actually said according to certain standards, you cannot use the Java's random number generator. So they actually had to buy a piece of hardware that they plug into the server, and this hardware generates the random number. Now what happened was whatever server that they had built, it had to pull from this hardware device. So what is the effect on the architecture? The effect on the architecture was, earlier, when a player was coming in or a new game was starting, the server itself could simply hand over some number. And keeping track or running that game again simply meant that you start the same server with the same seed. But now you can't do that anymore, because in real life you will have to ask this hardware device. But for testing you could still use the same one. So they actually had a switch within the server, whether it was for production or for staging. If it was production, you would call the hardware device. You have to get it from the hardware device. Now this the hardware device was very fast, but still you had to make a call, and that was a JNI thing, you know. They had to write something in the native interface, and when they make the call, they get that value and then pass it to the game server. Issue is this: the game server is not handling just one game; it's handling multiple games. So now the architectural effect was the game server had to now know when it is getting a request for a new game and when it makes a call for a random number. So here the random number in this case is not just a number, it's a card, one of the 52 cards. So get that, you have to know to whom to give it. So if 10 of you are asking me, when I make calls to the hardware device, I have to know to which of you I have to give this back. So you had to keep track of this. This basically took them, believe it or not, it took them just a couple of days to implement, but it took them 3 sprints to test and show that it is tested. It took them 3 sprints to do it. Okay. These are few good programming habits. Carefully structured log messages. Maybe this is a bit similar to what Joshua was speaking in the morning. If you want to make things safe, or maybe I'm making it too grand, but if you got too many log messages out of your server and there are many people doing, you know, firing a lot of events, you will not be able to keep track. You know, it's not more rubbish. You don't want too many log messages. You have to be very careful with your log messages. So there was some careful structuring of log messages there. So these are steps taken to increase testability. Actually, when we did a whole retrospective for the entire team, one of the questions we asked is, what if you didn't take these steps for testability? The other one that I've not shown, or I don't know if this is there on the slide. Yeah, okay, in this slide as well. If you look at the left side, on the top, you have your bots. So they actually made little virtual robots, software agents that will play the game. So you could configure them to play a poker game as good players, as bad players. Remember all that? The tester had to be sometimes a good player or a bad player. So you could actually set some parameters and you could play, you could get these bots to play multiple games simultaneously. So one of the questions we asked the team was, suppose you hadn't done many of these things upfront, how would that have worked for the project? And it was very clear answer that doing this helped the project multiple ways, because they sometimes remembered some other projects. Remember, when is the time we do testing? If not in Scrum, but in the general waterfall, what's the time we do testing? At the very towards the end, what is the time we don't want to find bad news? What's the worst time to find bad news? Towards the end. Well, that is when the pressure is highest. So if you don't have this testing infrastructure and then you're finding bad news, how would most people react to it? They would react to it like headless chickens, basically. So it gets into the death march mode. We skip this. Let me come towards the close of my talk, because there's a couple of things on testability that we have discussed already. So this is a hypothetical question, because at the beginning of the project, it was not a Scrum thing. But just for a coffee table discussion, we did discuss what would happen if there had been a sprint zero. because later on in consulting I met, I went to a lot of companies. I'm trying now trying to bring the lessons of this project to other projects. I go to companies and when they start off on Scrum, they often talk about, let's have a sprint zero. Trust me on this, this is a true story. There's a team I coached along with, we did the coaching for a whole release. When the next release came, sadly, they started with, no, they started with sprint minus one. It was even worse. They started with sprint minus one and then sprint zero. And the funny story is, when they did sprint, they were midway in sprint one. Then they got news from their customers in the US that something else is important. So all the planning, so basically they used sprint minus one and zero to do a bit of planning and, you know, gathering some courage or having some plans or some crutches to go and do the rest of the release. They did all that for 2+ sprints and then the news came that we have to implement something completely different. Okay? So why do we start with sprint zero? Why do so many projects have sprint zero in there? Well, we'd like to think that that is because programmers like counting from zero. They don't count from one like normal people, they count from zero. So that is why we have sprint zero. But the reality is sad, it is much worse. We start from sprint zero because we are flat-footed, lily-livered poltrons who don't have the guts to really try something. And the idea is you really have to try something, get a result. If you are good or if you are the right people, you will get some result. It may not be the perfect result. But then you have to inspect and adapt your way out. So the question is, if there was a sprint zero, what would we have done? We would have done nothing. We would have learned nothing. Because we would seriously do any work. Because serious work is for sprint one onwards. Minus one and zero is not for serious work. It's just something you do to prepare for the work. So you don't really work.
What will you go for sprint zero or minus one from second release?
It is a very painful story because we coached them for a whole release. And then, well, I think, that's a good point. Actually it's there next. So instead, we should take a cold hard look at where we are on the Stacey diagram. Do people know what a Stacey diagram is? Imagine an x and y axis. 0, 0, everything is simple. On the y axis, let us say it is the technology domain, it is a technology thing, and up there is uncertain. That is, we don't know what kind of technology we'll use or what kind of approach we will use technically. On the x-axis, again, 0 is very simple. We know exactly what we are doing, what we want to do, and away is complex. That is, we don't know what we want to build. That's the domain of functional. So Stacey diagram is basically, one is technology, one is what, and one is how. So when what and how both are very simple, we know what we are doing and we know how to do it because many of us have done something before, then it's okay. We don't feel afraid. So tomorrow if you are asked to do a little web page that just, you know, is a static web page, you're not afraid. You just say, yeah, okay, I'll do it in a day or whatever. And you don't give much thought. In the Stacey diagram, when both are complex, both are high, then we are very unsure. And we don't do this consciously. So I think when we go into a new project, we should look at the Stacey diagram and we have to look at where we are on the Stacey diagram. Now what's the relevance? Because if we know we are high up there, we are not sure of what we are going to build and we are not sure of how we are going to build it, then we don't need these numbers, minus 1 and 0 and all this. We will say, let us do a sprint, let us look for a result, let us try to build this thing. And if we can't build it, there is no shame, because we know it was not going to be that easy anyway. If anyone is following the news, remember the probe on the comet? Yeah, you know, there was a lot of suspense about whether it would land or what would happen. But if it didn't land, no one would blame anyone. If you think about Joshua's talk, we don't fear failure. Actually, we fear blame. So if you know that everything is there, it is complex, it's a complex thing we are attempting, there's no fear in that. So it's okay. So we look at the Stacy diagram and then we say, okay, maybe these first few sprints, maybe we're going to fail, not a problem. But let's actually try to do something, get a potentially shippable product out. Yeah, that's something. Yeah, do you have a question?
Yeah, I wanted to know, do you have sprints in this project?
Oh, so they were not sprints like a two-week traditional scrum sprint, because there was no scrum, but it was very much iterative. It was every month we had to do a demonstration and so on. Yes. So we never called it sprints.
Yeah, but sprint 0 or not comes when you're calling sprints. So we did not have sprints.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How do you know whether you're actually something like sprint 0 in the beginning where you try to find some little digital architecture?
No, no, there was, in this team there was no such thing, because first of all, in this team, the team had many people who had done a similar project before. So there was no fear in this team. The point is, many of the team members have gone to other companies, and then we see, you know, so we go to other companies and we find performance worse instead of getting better because of this fear of, yeah, and having a sprint zero and all. So this is a lesson. I'm not, the sprint zero, this particular slide is not about this project. It has nothing to do with this project. It is, so the case study is to show that architectural changes can also be handled. May not be always easily, but you need not have the fear. The other thing is, if architecturally we have to do something new, you may fail in a sprint. Don't take the crutches of sprint zero. That is the message of this slide. No. No, sprint zero is actually an anti-pattern, and it is, I think, an outcome of most people's lack of confidence in getting something done. Okay, so that's because, you know, but they don't want to say that we are not sure, etc., etc. So they try to give themselves some breathing space. So that's what they do. Oh, okay. Can I finish the slide and we take questions, or how is it working here?
Sure.
Yeah? This actually just one more slide. So the experience of this project in general, it reminds us that first of all, it's nothing to do with sprint zero, but testing cannot be an afterthought. It has to be something that you think about very early, even if it is about architecture. Because mostly architectures are very far away from testing and the thoughts of testing. It's very important. It's a role collaboration. You must think about, if I build the system, it is supposed to do all these great things, and my architecture is supposed to be great. How do I prove it? It isn't a holy cow. It can change. Architecture can change. Let's go to the last two points. So don't be tentative in action. It's the kind of theme of this conference. Action precedes clarity. So don't be tentative. Don't fear failure. Just make sure that there's safety. Just try it out, learn, move. You get some result. One trick we didn't do in this project that was bad was we didn't prioritize. Because had we prioritized the architecture properly, I think there would have been less pain in trying to handle it. again, don't be fooled. Many of these architectural changes we could handle, but it was not without pain. There was some pain. Yeah. But the pain would have been less had we prioritized the architectural needs better earlier on, which we didn't do. Okay. With that, I close the formal part of the talk and open to take questions. Yeah. So there were some questions. Yeah. Yes.
So if you're saying we don't need a spring zero, where would you ideally place in all the proof of concepts or any other groundwork that you want the project to start?
Spring 23. No, so the thing is, you know, this is playing on our mind a lot that we need a sprint zero because, but if you look at the Ralph Stacey diagram and have an open conversation with your stakeholders and say, but in the Ralph Stacey diagram, suppose you are at 0-0 and then you say that, oh, you know, we are not sure. When would you do a proof of concept? When you are not sure, right? So you say you are not sure, so sprint, let it be in. If it turns out wonderful, that means it's a great success. Either we are lucky or we are very good or both. So that's okay. But people need to know that if you are attempting something that is non-standard, that, yeah, well, it may not work out as you thought. It may be different. Organizations need to just relax, you know, be comfortable with that thought. Yeah. Any other question? Yeah.
What I've seen is most transformation projects.
Okay.
Try to have the sprint zero because it's money which is flowing, the resources are going to be utilized. Right? So, one can use on the project, right? And you want to move into a chair, you don't want to do without the sprint zero. You have to have a second plan. Plan B, you are safe. Right? And if it is going to be more than 50, 80, over 15, which are going to be different.
So the question is, if you have a big project and it's very expensive and you want to move from waterfall into this, it's running and you, yeah, so you want to do a pilot, that's okay, do a pilot, but do a pilot as a serious pilot. No. Pilot is you do real activity, but it could be over many sprints. Sprint zero is within the pilot. If you say in sprint zero, by the way, okay, let me define sprint zero. Sprint zero is when a sprint where people are doing some activity without saying that we need to get something shippable working at the end of the thing. Yeah, that is sprint zero. That's how most people understand sprint zero. Look, I am basically saying sprint zero is nonsense, so I don't care. But most people understand sprint zero as a place where you do not have to actually ship anything. Whereas I think
the outcome is that they call it
sprint zero. No, they already planned for it. I'm saying this is our sprint zero. We are preparing to do sprint one well. So we'll do a lot of planning, we'll do some architecting, then we'll do some documentation, and yeah. So that I'm saying don't do that. Pull me off the stage. Thank you everyone for your patient listening. You can catch me and I'll give you more grief.